My name is Katie Hodge, and I would like to welcome everybody to tonight's presentation from the DC Audubon Society. Just a quick introduction to this DC chapter. We exist to promote the appreciation of birds and conservation of habitats and all their form. We strive to be inclusive of people regardless of background, all your typical nationality, race, gender, orientation, and also inclusive of your background of whether you are a beginning birder, someone who's curious about birding, or somebody who's been birding for a very long time. So one of the things that we have been doing is having webinars, and I am going to hand over to Danny Sloan, who is one of the key volunteers in the education committee in setting these up, and he will be introducing our speaker.
Great, thank you, Katie. Excited for this tonight. It's a bit of a reminder of my days in California. Love acorn woodpeckers, as do most people who have seen them before. But I'm excited to welcome Sahas Barbe. He's gonna be presenting the complicated social life of a hoarder, the acorn woodpecker. He's a postdoctoral fellow at the Smithsonian National Museum of Natural History, where he serves as an avian ecologist interested in understanding why some birds are social and what is the evolutionary benefit of social behavior to these birds. He's an active researcher who's been published in several academic journals and has presented at conferences globally. In addition, he served as an academic mentor, nature guide, and consultant for the BBC. And for the local people, that's British Broadcasting Company, not Baltimore Bird Club. So. But at the end of the day, he loves birds and has a goal of seeing 6,000 species by the time he turns 60. So welcome, Sahas, and how close are you to that goal?
Thanks, Danny. I'm about a third of the way through, but I'm more than half of the way through to 60, so I'm still behind. I need to catch up a little bit.
Great. So, well, I'm going to hand it off to you to take things away.
Sure.
And
thank you so much. Thank you so much, Danny and Katie, for inviting me. And let me share my screen. And Katie, if you can give me a quick thumbs up that you can see the first slide. Perfect. OK, so welcome, everyone. And thanks again to DC Audubon for giving me the opportunity to present some of our research to you. And I'm going to try and talk to you about the complicated social life of acorn woodpeckers. There we go. So before we begin, let me tell you a little bit about myself. I grew up in a quaint little town called Mumbai in India, with about a population of about 20 million people. But despite being what is called a megapolis, Mumbai has a lot of really cool birds. You can see two species of flamingos in Mumbai, and a bunch of forest birds. And even today, with its burgeoning population, you can easily have a day with over 100 species without leaving the city limits. So Mumbai is still close to my heart and is a pretty good place to bird. But I got tired of the crowds pretty quickly. And for my PhD, I moved to two pretty remote places. The first was upstate New York, in Ithaca, New York, where I did my PhD. And then to a village in the remote Himalayan mountains with a total population of 9 permanent residents. And I spent many months on end in this remote Himalayan field site studying what drives the elevation distribution of birds. And this mountainside that you're seeing in front of you is a big elevation gradient. So the bottom of the mountain is at about 5,000 feet. The top of the mountain is about 15,000 feet. And there are about 300 species of birds that live along the mountainside. So it's a pretty cool place to work. And on top, there are wild goats and bears and all that fun stuff. So, but today I'm gonna talk about this enigmatic bird, the acorn woodpecker. If you have traveled out west, you've probably seen these birds. They are noisy, they are social, they make these big granaries, and they're found all throughout the western US, all the way to almost Washington. Hopefully, or for one reason or the other, they're expanding north and they'll be in Washington soon. but they also occur all the way down through Central America into Colombia and in the Northern Andes Mountains. So Frank Leach in 1925 made this really interesting observation and wrote about it in the journal Auk, and he called it the communism in the California woodpecker, as it was called back then. And what he said was that one of the most puzzling features of nest building in this species was that more than a pair of woodpeckers seemed to be interested in the proceedings. And so in the 1920s, it was considered that most birds live and breed as simple pairs, as simple male and female pairs. And that's how birds breed. They're not as social, or they're at least not as social when it comes to reproduction. So beyond that, that observation led to a person called Dr. McRoberts to study these birds further. And he also saw in, this was in California, he saw that there were more than two birds feeding nestlings. And he was really perplexed as to who these birds were, why were they feeding nestlings, who were the actual breeders, who were these birds that were supposedly helpers. And what he realized was that these birds that were feeding these chicks were actually offspring from previous years. So he called them helpers at the nest. And there was this growing literature of species that show what is called cooperative breeding, where more than two birds take care of the offspring in the nest. And they show this really interesting behavior where there are some helpers that are taking care of young that are not their own. So obviously the question is, why are these helpers helping instead of breeding on their own? Why not have your own kids and instead help your parents raise siblings? So McRoberts and other people believed that there was some ecological constraint on their ability to farm, to go and stake out their own territory and to breed independently of their parents. And so the prevailing understanding was that some birds or some individuals of stay back in their territory where they're born because they cannot go and breed independently. So that was in the 1960s, late 60s, early 70s. Now, let's take a step further back, and let me tell you that this cooperative breeding, where more than two individuals take care of the offspring, is actually not that uncommon in birds. In fact, it is very common and is found in about 9% of all living birds. And cooperative breeding as a breeding strategy has evolved multiple times independently. So it has evolved multiple times in ostriches, or rather it has evolved in ostriches, bush tits, jays, woodpeckers, mouse birds. So there are so many different families of birds in which cooperative breeding has evolved independently of each other. So what is the benefit of cooperative breeding? Why does it keep popping up again and again and again in bird evolutionary biology? So let's take a look back at the grand old man of evolution, Charles Darwin, and what his theory of evolution by natural selection said is that, to put it roughly, he said the survival of the fittest, right? And so the fit here are the individuals that leave behind the most copies of their DNA. And so he suggested that there are some animals that have these beneficial adaptations. They leave behind most the most number of babies. Those most number of babies inherit those adaptations and then go on to have more babies. And so the frequency of this adaptation increases in the population, leading to evolution. But for the longest time, it was considered that this higher fitness only meant that you had more offspring or more babies. And that was the only way of having fitness. But I want to sort of ask you, another question. Is that true? Does it have to be offspring? And I want to sort of take a step back and ask you to answer in the chat, who else shares your DNA with you? Who else in this world shares your DNA or the most DNA with you? And it'd be great if you can quickly put some words in the chat. Who else shares DNA with you? Siblings, okay. Janet says siblings, that's correct. Sister, grandparents, perfect. Anyone else? Distant relatives, absolutely. So let me share my screen again. So you're absolutely right in saying that it's brothers and sisters and cousins and nieces and nephews and grandchildren, they all share our DNA. And so the next question is, how much DNA do they share? So how much DNA do your kids or offspring share with you? I gave the answer away. So let's roll with that. So your kids share about 50% of your genome. Your siblings also share 50% of your genome. And your sisters or brothers' offspring share about 25% of your genome with you. So let's talk about these leaving the most number of copies of your DNA in the gene pool behind. Having two kids is mathematically the same as making sure that two of your siblings grow up to be adults and breed on their own, okay? So if you are a helper that cannot breed on your own, helping two siblings reach maturity gives you the same evolutionary fitness or evolutionary advantage as having two kids of your own. The same way, raising four kids or helping raise four kids of your sister or your brother or brothers and sisters is the same as is having two kids of your own or helping raise two siblings. So if you're out there and if you have two siblings, then you have already been replaced in a gene pool. If you have two siblings and two kids, you've been replaced twice in the gene pool. So I have a big family and I have more than eight first cousins, which means that those eight first cousins have already replaced me, and they all have kids. So being a person who is child-free, I can be rest assured that my genes have been left behind or been reproduced in the gene pool already without me directly having to breed or have children of my own. Okay, so you need two kids, two siblings, and four nieces or nephews to replace yourself in the gene pool. And so this led to this really cool theory called kin selection or evolution of kin selection, which basically said that organisms that help raise siblings or close relatives left behind more copies of their DNA. So these helpers who may help raise two siblings and then go on to have children of their own left behind more copies of their DNA, which led to these more social birds in the population have a higher prevalence or leave behind or sort of higher prevalence of these of this sociality trait. And this increased the prevalence of cooperative breeding in the population. And finally, this obviously opened a whole plethora of new questions, because if I'm having my own children or if I'm raising siblings, they have the same fitness value. But it's always better to raise your own children than raise your brother's or sister's children, because it has half the fitness value, right? So how does cooperation and cooperative breeding evolve when every individual is trying to maximize their own individual fitness? And that was the burning question in the 70s in behavioral ecology, behavioral psychology, and evolutionary biology. So that brings us back to the acorn woodpecker. And I'm gonna be talking about acorn woodpeckers for the rest of the seminar. And all the research that I'm gonna talk about took place in this beautiful place called the Hastings Natural History Reservation in Carmel Valley, California. It's a UC Berkeley research station, and it's one of the oldest biological research stations in North America. It's in Monterey County in central coastal California. All the research I'm gonna talk about today it has been spearheaded by this guy, Walt Koenig, who still lives in Carmel Valley. And I'm gonna talk about a research that has been collected over almost 50 years. And obviously one person can't do all that. And there's more than 150 field assistants that have worked on this project over the years. And I've been associated with this project for nearly 4 years now. So we can go back and think about this acorn woodpecker social system, right? So we talked about there are these male and female breeders, and then there are these helpers who are the offspring of the previous generation, previous year, and they help raise siblings. So when Walt actually started studying these woodpeckers and studying the woodpecker groups in closely, what he realized was that the acorn woodpecker social system was actually much more complicated than this very simple breeder-helper dichotomy. He realized that in the 60-odd acorn woodpecker social groups that we follow continuously, and we've been following since 1972, there are multiple different kinds of social systems happening simultaneously. So there are some groups that are simple pairs, which are just your male and female pair that lives on their own territory. Then there are groups that are what are called polyandrous groups, which means that there are more males than females. And this generally manifests as a single female with two males that both cooperatively breed with her and help raise the chicks cooperatively. There are also polygynous groups, which means that there are two or more females that breed with one male, and that and those females joint nest. And we'll be talking about that later. Then there are groups that are called polygynandrous, and acorn woodpeckers are one of the few birds in the world that have what is called cooperative polygamy, where there are multiple male breeders, multiple female breeders, and they all live on the same territory and have a communal nest where they share the responsibility of raising the offspring in the nest cooperatively, all those breeders together. And all these different breeding systems can have these non-breeding helpers also. So there can be as many as 15 birds that are closely related to each other that live on the same territory. So the acorn woodpecker group size varies from 2 birds to 15. And I think this year there was one group with 16 birds. So it's a very diverse and dynamic social system. The other absolutely cool part about acorn woodpeckers is that they build these huge granaries. So acorn woodpeckers build what are called acorn storage structures called granaries. And granaries are individual holes drilled into the bark of the of oak trees or in dead parts of oak and sycamore trees typically. And they store individual acorns in these holes, and they can store thousands and thousands of acorns. So the biggest granaries at Hastings, where we study these birds, have tens of thousands of holes. It's really difficult to count each one of them, but we think there may be upwards of 40,000 holes in some of these granaries. Now, we know that each of these granaries, each of these holes takes about 30 minutes to make. So if you do the math, that's a lot of woodpecker hours of chipping away at wood to make each of these holes. And the holes are specialized. There are different sized holes for each species of oak acorn that they store. And so there are some holes that are specially made for valley oaks. There are some oaks, some holes that are specially made for coast live oak acorns, et cetera, et cetera. And so these granaries then become really, really valuable resources for them, because these stored acorns are extremely useful for them in the winter. Acorn woodpeckers are also special in another aspect is that they don't necessarily rely on bark feeding insects like most other woodpeckers in North America. They're actually flycatchers. So on the typical day, if it's hot and sunny, you will find acorn woodpeckers sitting at the top of a tree and sallying out like a phoebe does to catch insects. And they love eating big grain flies. But on cold, rainy California winters, there are very, very few flying insects. And so that's when they rely on these acorns food. And these big granaries and the acorns stored in them make or break decide whether an individual acorn woodpecker will actually survive the winter. So overwinter survival of individuals is very, very tightly correlated to how many acorns they can store. Okay, so Now, basically, Woodpecker, Acorn Woodpecker Society is thus a, if you, they live in these California oak savanna habitat, and they are basically groups that have granaries and that fight and protect their granaries all year round. So Acorn Woodpecker Society, as if you may let me call it that, is habitat with different territories with their own granaries all living together, living permanently on those territories, interacting with one another. And so what that means is that because you cannot breed or you can't be successful breeding without having a granary of your own, and because these granaries take so long to build, we have some granaries that we think are more than 100 years old. So because these territories with granaries are limited in the landscape, we think that these helpers stay back and can't breed as soon as they become an adult because there aren't enough territories out there. Okay, so they stay back and help raise chicks that their parents have, and they're constantly looking for ways or to a way to find a territory and start breeding on their own. So then the question is, how do you acquire a granary? How do you acquire a territory, and how do you become an active breeder and lose your helper status? So to understand that, let's quickly think of a scenario where there is one a breeding pair at a territory. Let's say there's one male and one female breeder, and the female has two daughters that are her non-breeding helpers, and one son living on the same territory. Now, these helpers are directly related to these adults, and so they can't, the females and the males, these helpers cannot mate with their parents and thus are non-breeding helpers. So just like any kind of wealth, there are two ways of acquiring a granary. You can either fight tooth and nail for it and work really hard to win one, or you can just inherit a granary. So let me walk you through that. So let's consider that this male dies. Now the breeder male has died, and the only other male in the territory is this breeder female's son. And there is pretty strong incest avoidance in the Acorn Woodpeckers, which means that these birds cannot, this female cannot mate with her son. And so what that results in is a multi-group fight between multiple coalitions of males from other groups. So because this female can only breed with unrelated males from all over the landscape come and fight one another until one group defeats all other groups and move in to this territory. So they have to fight to win a breeding territory at this granary. Now, the other cool thing is now that these three new males have moved into this territory, the two female helpers that are in this group are also unrelated to the male breeders in the group. So they inherit the territory and they become co-breeders or joint nesters with their mother. So the only bird remaining on the territory is this helper male, and he gets kicked out immediately because there are these three males that don't want another male competing with them at the group. So the two female helpers inherit the territory, while these three males had to fight and work really hard to win this territory. So those are the two ways you can acquire a granary. But let's think a little more about how do they find out that there's a territory that's available and up for grabs in the first place? And so we know that this territory acquisition takes place really quickly, and at least the fight for it starts really, really quickly. And we always wondered about how do these fights for territories, what we call power struggles, start within minutes of a breeder dying at a territory. We were really, really curious as to how this information flows through this population so quickly. And so over the last few years, we've put these really high-end nanotags on these birds to understand just that. So let me walk you through again what happened. So let's consider this is a territory, this is a Acorn Woodpecker territory with a big granary, and a breeder has just died. And as soon as the breeder dies, within minutes, and within minutes meaning like 20, 25 minutes, you have multiple coalitions of birds coming in to fight one another. And again, this can be both male and female birds. And so if it's a female breeder that has died, then female coalitions come. And if it's a male bird that has died, then male coalitions come and fight one another until one coalition beats all other coalitions. And this itself is very, very rare in the animal kingdom. In most conflicts in animal kingdom, including humans, it's always a two-way fight. There's always some cooperation within rival groups, and it's always us versus them. But because the stakes are so high and the benefits of winning a good granary are so high, these coalitions fight all the other coalitions simultaneously. So what happens during these coalitions? There is a lot of posturing. So these coalitions show everyone who they are with and who they're where they've come from, and they're calling really loudly. There's a lot of fighting. These birds are extremely violent. They gouge each other's eyes out. They break each other's wing. They fall to the ground fighting. There's a lot of violent fighting. But the other crazy thing is that there's a lot of birds watching. And we had always known this. We had always known there were birds watching. We just didn't know who these birds were. And it's really, really difficult to sort of quantify this behavior. And we knew that these birds fight, and sometimes these fights go on for days, but it's so chaotic with upwards of 40 birds fighting and in more than 12 or dozen or more coalitions fighting simultaneously. It's really difficult, even with color-banded birds, to identify individuals fighting. And it's almost impossible to determine how long each bird is fighting. And we really wanted to know how much effort these birds are putting into winning a granary that they can live at for the rest of their lives. And these birds are really long lived. So the longest bird that we've had living in our population was 19 years old when he died. And that was a male, and the female was also 18 years. So if you win a big granary at the age of three, you have a long life ahead of you where you can have many, many babies. So these granaries are really, really crucial for their survival. So we decided to study them using radio tags, which are these, and the radio tags that we used are really ultra light radio tags. So they weigh less than half a gram in weight, and they're solar powered. So in California, thankfully, there's no shortage of the sun. And so we can put these solar powered radio tags on the backs of acorn woodpeckers. They sit on the back. If you've ever gone rock climbing in your life, it fits exactly like a rock climbing harness with a fanny pack on your back. And that fanny pack looks at, whenever there is sunlight falling on the fanny pack, the solar panel picks it up, and the radio tag produces a radio signal that is picked up by these receivers. So the receivers are also solar powered. And so our system is completely solar powered, and we have a big array of solar powered radio tag receivers in the landscape. So as soon as an acorn woodpecker flies over one of these receivers, it gets picked up by the receiver, and we know at what time on what date was that individual acorn woodpecker there. So we studied three power struggles for the study that I'm going to talk about today. And these were all female power struggles. So there were only females fighting at this power struggle. And we had 36 radio tagged woodpeckers that were present at the power struggles. Out of these, 13 were what we called warriors, or birds that were actually fighting to become breeders at these groups. But we also discovered 23 what we call spectators. These birds were either males, so they couldn't move to the group, or they were females that already had breeding territories of their own. And so they didn't stand to disperse or move to this territory to breed on their own. But yet we found that they were there and they were visiting regularly. So how much time do they spend there? Well, we found that some birds spent over 10 hours a day for multiple days visiting power struggle sites. And birds came from really far away. So some birds came from over 3,000 meters away, which is about 2 miles away. And these birds were present for about an hour every day, just watching. And these birds were not fighters. They were just coming there to gain social information about which birds, or we think, gain social information about which birds were fighting to win access to the biggest mansions in the neighborhood. We also, we did see that as we thought was logical, these warriors, these birds that were actually fighting to win access to the power struggle, spent a lot of time at these power struggles. So some birds spent over 600 minutes every day fighting, which is more than 10 hours every day, and they came back every day and day in and day out to fight. But these spectators, these birds that did not stand to gain any direct benefit from the power struggles, also spent several hours. So some individuals spent up to almost 8 hours just watching these power struggles. The other crazy thing about this study was that we saw that spectators actually came from farther away from where the warriors came. So you have to imagine that these birds have their own granaries. These spectators have their own granaries, and they have to leave their own granaries unguarded to fly and watch these power struggles, right? So they are actually risking their status in their group when they come to do these forays. But we think that the social information that they gain from watching these power struggles is just so important to them that they're ready to take this risk. And they are ready to fly farther than the warriors that actually stand to benefit from these power struggles. And finally, they came for as many days as the warriors did. So these spectators, which we thought in the beginning were really unimportant birds, turned out to be really, really interesting from a sociological and behavioral point of view, because these power struggles lasted for about 5 days, and these same birds came again and again and again for about 5 days also. So they really wanted to know what the final outcome of the power struggle was. So we learned that these birds spent a lot of time. So some birds spent over 40 hours fighting at these power struggles, and yet were unsuccessful in winning the territory. So our radio tag birds were unsuccessful in winning the territory. And imagine there's no sort of parallel in the bird world where we know of such violent conflicts for so long for one unsuccessful attempt at winning a territory. And so these unsuccessful birds likely fight really hard at multiple power struggles before they can win a granary and a territory to breed at. But we also realize that these spectators, birds that did not stand to benefit directly from the power struggles, also spent a lot of time gathering social information or hanging or just watching a good old fight at these power struggles. Okay, so from that, let's move to the next part of my talk. And let's go back to our first example. So we talked about these three females, the one mother and her two daughters that are now co-joint nesting with their mom, and these three unrelated males that move in into their territory and have become the male breeders. So let me refresh your minds. There are two ways to win a territory in acorn woodpeckers. You either wait for your opposite sex parent to die. So if you're a female, you wait for your dad to die, or if you're a male helper, you wait for your mom to die. So unrelated opposite sex birds move into your territory, and then you inherit that territory and co-breed with your parent. So, but the question is, how do they do it? Now, if it's three sisters that are co-breeding, or mother and daughters and they're co-breeding, imagine that you have to remember that these individuals have to maximize their fitness, right? And that's what the assumption is that these birds are not really altruistic, but they are cooperating, but at the same time trying to maximize their own fitness. So there's competition between those three females that are co-breeding with each other. So there's intra-sexual competition, but there's also intersexual competition between males and females to maximize their reproductive output. So how do they do it? How do they have communal cooperative nests when everyone is trying to maximize their own individual fitness? So let me tell you that joint nesting, where these multiple females have a communal cooperative joint nest, is actually extremely rare in birds. In fact, there are only 8 birds in the world that are known to have this behavior, where there are joint nesting females in the population. And these birds include a couple of species of mouse birds that live on the plains of Africa, these Ani cuckoos that live in Central and South America, Acorn Woodpeckers, of course, these white-throated magpie jays that live in Central America again, and a bird that lives on the island of Taiwan in the South China Sea called the Taiwan euhina. They all show this joint nesting behavior. Now, let's try and understand quickly why this joint nesting is so complicated. Now, the problem with that is that there's this intersexual competition, because polyandry, where one female is having the babies of several males, is the best case scenario for this female, because that one female can breed with multiple males and all of those males cooperatively take care of all of her children. So she can maximize her reproductive output because she has multiple caregivers for her babies. And so for females, polyandry is the best case scenario. And so the prediction then flows through that if you have joint nesting females, then you would always expect those joint nesting females to maintain this polyandrous ratio, sex ratio in the group, which means that if there are 2 females in the group that are joint nesting, you would expect those groups to have more than 2 males breeding. So there's a skewed male bias sex ratio to make this situation beneficial for the females. For the males, it's exactly opposite. For males, polygyny is the best case scenario, right? So one male breeds with multiple females, he fertilizes all those females and all of them take care of all his kids. And so he can maximize his individual fitness by having multiple females joint nesting with him. So the scenario then is that how may joint nesting females benefit males? Well, as you can imagine, when there are multiple males and multiple females, there is competition between individual males to have the most number of direct babies, because those direct babies have higher fitness than raising your brother's or your dad's babies, right? And so having multiple females will give you an advantage of making sure that you at least have some babies in that in the pile of offspring that you make that year. So even if there is a dominant male in the group, he can't mate guard and make sure that each female in the group is only mates with him. And so it reduces what is called the reproductive skew in the clutch. So if there are multiple males and multiple females, then it increases the chance that each individual male will have some direct progeny in the nest. So even within acorn woodpeckers, even within the acorn woodpeckers that we study in this about 60 odd groups that we study, joint nesting is really rare. So about 78% of the groups have only one breeding female, and about 20% of the groups have up to 4 co-breeding females. Now, as you can imagine, when these multiple females are laying their eggs in a common nest, if one female starts laying eggs really early, then her chicks will hatch out really early, and those chicks will dominate the chicks of all her sisters or all her daughters' chicks. And so those other joint nesting females that started laying eggs later will lose out, because their chicks won't be strong enough and won't beg as vigorously as the first nester's chicks. And so these birds have devised a really, really sort of cruel strategy to make sure there is equity in how many eggs each female gets to lay. And so let's consider a simple scenario where there are 2 sisters, Anna and Elsa, and they are joint nesting. And then, so Anna lays an egg in the cavity. So this is my crude cartoon of a cavity. So that's the cavity entrance, and that's the cavity inside the wood. This is the trunk of a tree. And Anna has laid an egg in the cavity. acorn woodpeckers don't really make a nest inside the cavity like chickadees or house wrens. They just lay their eggs on a pile of wood chips. But Elsa is not ready to lay eggs yet. And so what she does is she tosses the egg out. So she destroys the egg of her own sister because she's not ready to lay eggs. And Anna laying eggs early will give Anna's babies a head start over Elsa's babies. Okay, so that's awkward. Next day, Anna comes in, sees her eggs missing, but she is ovulating. So she lays another egg. Elsa does the same thing. She tosses the egg out. So Anna, or female A, as if you want to call her that, generally wisens up to the game pretty quickly and stops laying and won't lay eggs until Elsa has laid her first egg. And then she immediately starts her ovulating process and they start laying simultaneously. And which means that the eggs that are laid in the nest, they can't recognize as their own. And then they raise the chicks cooperatively also. So let's consider a three female scenario. This gets more complicated because then Anna lays an egg, Elsa tosses it out. Then their little sister lays an egg, Elsa tosses it out. And this continues. And so in joint nesting female acorn woodpeckers, up to 38%, or actually on average, 38% of the eggs that are laid by the females are tossed out because they're not in sync with their sisters or joint nesters. So why go through all of this pain when you can breed independently? Why not just wait another couple of years until you can breed? And that brings us back to those granaries. So we found that the number of females or the incidence of joint nesting increased with population density. So as the population density of acorn woodpeckers increased over time, the number of territories that were available for breeding reduced because those territories became saturated. And there was no free granary for each individual female to go nest at. And so if there are very few granaries available, then the females do what is called the best of a bad job and have some direct fitness, have one or two babies of their own instead of not having babies at all and staying back at their group as a helper. So a survey of 867 nests that we have followed over the last 48 years showed that each individual female that joint nested, so these two female groups and these three female groups actually produced not that many more chicks. They actually, so the nest with a single female produces only produces 3.5 eggs on average, but with the addition of these extra breeders, they only produce about an extra chick, that's it. So the female breeders, they joint nest and they try to make the best of a bad job and have some direct fitness and the inclusive fitness that they get by helping raise the chicks of their close kin instead of not nesting or not breeding at all. They do take this further. So if you remember, we had that initial prediction that to make this beneficial for the females should have a sex bias ratio where there are more males than females. And so we did see that on average, when there are joint nesting females in the group, those joint nesting groups tend to have more males than groups that have a single breeder female. So they try to make it a good deal for themselves. The males also benefit from this situation, actually. So we did see that when there is only one breeder female and multiple breeder males, there is high reproductive skew. So one male can dominate and have most and father most of the chicks in the brood. But when there are multiple females, a few more males get a chance to breed and have direct offspring. So what that means is that the environment and population density directly have an effect on the sociality and social complexity of these birds. And so the environment drives how social these birds are. And that's pretty crazy, like to imagine, to think that these birds are plastic enough, their behaviors are plastic enough that they can go from bird that lives and breeds as a simple pair to joint nesting with their cousins. So to sort of round it all out, In 1925, there was a simple observation that there were more than two birds that were on a territory, and there were more than two birds excavating cavities and raising chicks. And that 50 years later, the Acorn Woodpecker Project in Carmel Valley, California at Hastings Reserve is now a textbook case and is actually in many ecology textbooks around the world. And I didn't talk to you about helpers today at all and the role they play in helping raise chicks, but Acorn Woodpeckers are world famous, and this study is known for its for the knowledge we have gained about the role of helpers for reproduction, the evolution of cooperative polygamy, this really rare but complicated social behavior, and increasingly we are using these radio tags to understand how animal social networks evolve. So we know now that these acorn woodpeckers are extremely curious birds. They want to go snoop on others, eavesdrop on others, track the group compositions and changes in group compositions in their landscape. And we think that they have the social complexity of a small human village, where if you live in a tiny village, you know where everyone works and where who's having an affair with whom and who's what everyone's doing and all that. And acorn woodpeckers sort of maintain that level of complexity. I also think that from this talk, you have sort of realized that there are many flavors of sociality. And even within, just like in humans, within acorn woodpeckers, there are multiple different kinds of social organizations and different social makeup of groups and family groups. That sociality has evolved multiple times throughout the animal kingdom. And in fact, even there are some bacteria that are known to be social, and there are fungi that are known to be social. And that humans are not the only complex social system, but there are many other complex social systems out there. And with that, I would like to thank the DC Audubon, the National Science Foundation, and many other donors for funding our work. I'm happy to take any questions. Thank you.
Great. Awesome. Thank you for the great presentation. Learned a lot tonight.
Thanks.
Hopefully everyone did. But are you ready for some questions? Because we've got a few.
Yes.
So I'm gonna start out with the one that just came in, just because mm-hmm. it's sitting right here in front of my face. But mm-hmm. how long is a helper a helper? Is it until another spot becomes available or something else?
Yes. So the helpers help until they can successfully disperse or until their opposite sex parent dies. So we have had helpers who have stayed as helpers at the group for 7 years or 8 years, I think is the record. Others that disperse in their second year as soon as they become adults. So it ranges.
Great, thanks. And then some of the questions also came in a little earlier, so just
sure.
Let me know if they were already covered
mm-hmm.
or not. But so does fighting for a granary only take place after the death of one of the owners? And the second part to this question, do groups ever try to attack one where the original family is still intact?
Right, that's a great question. And that's one of the coolest things about acorn woodpeckers is that until and unless all the breeders of a particular sex, male or female, are dead, there are very few forceful takeovers of the granary by another coalition. That's probably because there's generally helpers, and these helpers have a vested interest in defending their territory also, right? Because once the helpers move in, they are going to, once these unrelated birds take over, some of these helpers get pushed out. So there are very few occasions when a living breeder is challenged. It's probably happened like once or twice in the last 50 years of breeding. So the answer is no.
Yeah, it sounds like there's a kid's cartoon show about acorn woodpeckers, like ripe for the making with just the way their breeding behaviors go.
Meerkat Manor, I think there should be acorn woodpecker something also.
Yeah, so if anyone does that out there, just throw me a percent if it does well. So next question, of course the fire is going on out west, but do you know how these woodpeckers have done with fires that came through Hastings and other areas out west?
Thank you for asking that question. Yes, and so it totally depends on the granary. So acorn woodpeckers make, so in the recent fire, which are called the river fire, we lost about a third of our study area. So Hastings, about a third of Hastings burned down, and we lost about six granaries. So these granaries that were probably, well, at least we know, at least around in the 1920s, and were probably older than that also, burned down to the ground. And these birds become, it's a riches to rags, overnight riches to rags story, because these birds become paupers suddenly and can't live on their territory because they can't live without a granary. And so if you see oak savanna burning, it's decades of work by groups of acorn woodpeckers going up in flames. And some of these acorn woodpeckers are lucky because they build granaries in live trees, and live trees in California are especially blue oaks and valley oaks are pretty fire resistant. And so they don't burn down as much, but all the dead trees and like granaries and dead trees are completely gone.
Great, thank you. And then I believe this one may have been covered earlier, but just in case it hasn't, but what happens to the partner of the breeder that's died?
Mm-hmm. So they, unrelated breeders move in, and then the partner starts breeding with them. Great. And so, they just accept the winners of the power struggle.
Great. And then what's the life expectancy of acorn woodpecker on average?
The average life expectancy is about 6 years for males and about 4 years for females. So the females typically get two or three reproductive attempts in their lives, and males get about four or five.
Okay, great. And then are there worries about the decline of oak trees due to climate change?
Yes and no. So we really don't understand. So let me take a step back. Acorn woodpeckers rely heavily on oak acorns, as I mentioned. And acorn woodpeckers actually cannot live in habitats where there is only one species of oak. And that is because most oak trees don't have acorns every year or don't have a big crop of acorns every year. So acorn woodpecker habitat, the good acorn woodpecker habitat, is a woodland where there are two or three different species of oak, because then that makes sure that every year, at least one of those species is having a big crop of acorns. Now, we have a really bad understanding of what triggers a good acorn crop. What are the environmental drivers of a good acorn crop? And so we know that winters are warming, and I think what is more important is oaks are wind pollinated. So they need the conditions to be dry and windy when they are having flowers so they can pollinate each other. But we are getting more and more wet, damp conditions in March and April when these oaks are flowering now. And so we don't yet know whether that has a direct impact on the acorn crop. We still need a few years of data, but that is one effect of climate change, the increasing number of rainy days in March and April that might directly affect how well the acorn oaks are pollinating with one another.
Okay, and as a follow-up question, do you know how long it would take to have a statistically significant data set to understand that, or is that kind of out of your realm?
So that's a great question. And Walt Keating, who runs the Acorn Woodpecker Project, or ran the Acorn Woodpecker Project until my advisor, Eric Walters, took over, also does the California Acorn Survey. And so he goes out and counts acorns throughout California. And the answer is that there is enough, unfortunately, there is so much variability in the same place within a year. So because each oak species doesn't have a big crop of acorns every year, it'll take about five or six more years to truly understand what this changing climate has, how it has affected the amount of acorns that any one acorn tree produces, or one oak tree produces, sorry.
Okay. And Can you talk a little bit about the natural predators of acorn woodpeckers and who and what they are?
Mm-hmm. So baby acorn woodpeckers in the nest are pretty well guarded, but we know gopher snakes can get in and eat the whole clutch. We've had gopher snakes go in and eat entire clutches of acorn woodpeckers or one or more. Cooper's hawks and sharp-shinned hawks are both really, really active predators. And I told you, right, those acorn woodpeckers are sallying flycatchers. So they fly straight up into the air and are pretty exposed. And I've seen acorn woodpeckers, especially chicks that have just fledged the nest, are pretty vulnerable to Cooper's hawks, and they just get them very easily. But other than that, like unlike most other birds, they have very few predators, and that's why they are so long-lived.
Great. And then we got two more questions. Are there any differences in the breeding behaviors between the two North American or U.S. acorn woodpecker mm-hmm. subspecies?
Yes, that's a fantastic question also, because the southwestern subspecies doesn't actually build granaries. And they are a lot more transient in their habitat. So they move around a lot. They don't build big granaries in the southwest in Arizona, while the western population of acorn woodpeckers build granaries and are resident at the same place all year round.
Yeah, those of you who have been to Madera Canyon before, which is one of, you know, of course, one of the premier birding spots in mm-hmm. in the U.S. at, you know, at I think it's Santa Rita Lodge, sitting there watching all the hummingbirds, will often hear acorn woodpeckers right around you. So that's the southwest population, quite different. And then, let me see, how did the fighting female situation resolve itself?
So we still don't fully understand when a female group is declared the winner. And we know that they fight for multiple days, but it seems like the most persistent and the biggest coalition often wins. And that generally means that there are three or four birds. Another thing that we've seen anecdotally is because power struggles are won, there's strength in numbers, and the bigger coalitions tend to win power struggles. Anecdotally, we've even seen the mothers come and fight with their daughters or to help them move to a new territory. And then they go back to their home territory where they are breeders themselves. That didn't happen in the data that I showed you because all the breeding females that we had didn't have any female helpers, but we know that some female breeders will fly in with their daughters, fight with their daughters until they win, and then settle them down in their new accommodation and then move back to their territory.
Okay, great. So one more question for you, and then sure. it's 8 o'clock now, so mm-hmm. a little
that's
late,
fine.
But
mm-hmm.
okay. So this is a bit of a longer one, but are there any other bird species that have these quote unquote battle royale scenarios with multiple coalitions fighting for territory? And second part of the question, is there any research on the concrete benefits for spectators in terms of the value of the social information they collect, other than the fact that there must be value because they're willing to travel so far and spend so much time doing it?
But those are both in questions. The first is that there are several birds that have very, very, I don't know if they're violent, but they are very long lasting or pretty strong conflicts. So there's a bird called a pied babbler that lives in the Kalahari Desert of Africa. They're known to have pretty strong conflicts. There are fairy wren species in Australia that are known to have big conflicts. And so there are definitely birds out there that also show this, but at the same time, we don't think that there are birds that have this complex where there are dozens of coalitions fighting simultaneously fighting each other. That might be unique to acorn woodpeckers, just the sheer number of birds that are fighting simultaneously. And the second answer to your second question is we don't know. We know two things. We know that acorn woodpeckers track group membership pretty closely. So if you play the calls of two birds, individuals' calls of two individual birds that don't live together, if you call, make the play the calls as a duet from a third direction, acorn woodpeckers go in immediately, try and investigate. So they are really curious and they know where each bird lives on the landscape. How that information helps them is sort of anyone's guess. Maybe it makes sure, maybe they have a neighborhood where they know their neighbors and they all help each other signal for predators. And so they find it important to know who their neighbors are. It may also be another information packet that they may be getting is just looking at who the big coalitions in the landscape are, who are the dominant fighters, and they might be looking out for their present or future helpers. So if they have only one helper in the group and they're not going to be successful, they still know which groups have young breeders, which groups have breeders that are old and about to die and maybe up for grabs in the near future. So there are maybe multiple kinds of social information that these birds are gathering. And they don't only just move to these power struggles. Every acorn woodpecker, our radio telemetry data has shown, visits at least 4 or 5 different groups every day. And it's both breeders and helpers. And they visit these multiple groups every day to sort of track membership or get some track whose granary is the biggest and how many acorns they have stored. There are multiple potential avenues for research.
Okay, awesome. Oh, thank you for the great presentation. Thank you, everyone in the audience, for really,
thank you so much.
Really great questions. There's some definitely people out there with some very curious minds and great questions. I'm going to hand things off to Katie to close out the webinar.
Great. Thank you so much for having me.
Definitely. Just echo that. It's very fascinating. I have one or two announcements, and then I will let people go for their evening. I was reminded that the deadline for the Black and Latinx Birder Scholarship is coming up on November 1st. If you haven't heard about that, that is a scholarship being organized in the area for full-time students with an interest in birds and ecology. And I would invite you to go to our website, dcaudubonsociety.org, where you can get more information and a link to how to apply. So if you know anybody who might be interested, please share that information. We will be having our November's monthly birding forecast that we do the week before Thanksgiving. We haven't picked a date, but an announcement will be coming out shortly. And then for anybody who is not on our newsletter, I'd point out if you go to our website, you scroll all the way down, there's a place to put your name and your email address, and we use that to announce all of our activities. So if you're not on there, we'd be glad to have you join. And then of course, like most organizations these days, you can find us on most all of the social networks. So if you do Twitter or Facebook or Instagram, search DC Audubon and you can find us there. And we also this year started a YouTube channel, and we are recording this and we will post it in the coming days. So if you want to rewatch anything, keep a lookout for that. And with that, thank you all. Thank you, Sahas, and have a good night.
Yep. Bye, guys.